I'm going to talk to you today about things that I think about a lot, which maybe you don't, but hopefully you will after today. And that is, how is it possible that we are living in a world full of the toxic substance oxygen? And now, some people think that that's a strange statement to think about, but oxygen is one of the most toxic chemicals known to people. And to illustrate that point, I'm going to tell you about the very first mass extinction caused by pollution in the history of the world. And this happened about 3.5 billion years ago, when life was first starting to evolve in the primordial soup where these little critters emerged. And most little one-celled animals cruised around in this soup, perfectly content to eat methane and to eat sulfate. And everyone was pretty happy. You know, no, there weren't a lot of movers and shakers, but people were good. Well, people, the critters. And then one nasty little bug came along, and they started to make a toxic substance that killed off all their neighbors. And it was oxygen. This molecule came out of these animals, and it attacked their membranes, and it attacked their genetic material, whatever sort of thing it was, and it just tore holes in the whole world. Some people who are smarter than me and know about these things estimate that 99% of all of life died when oxygen started to build up in the atmosphere. It is to this day one of the most corrosive substances we know. Rust, oxygen. Burning, oxygen. Without oxygen, none of this chemistry happens. And without life, there is no oxygen. So oxygen is entirely a toxic substance produced by life, and it's really not very good for us, to be honest with you. On the other hand, some of these critters that didn't die back in the day were able to figure out a way to grab that oxygen and to use it to generate energy. And it was so good at that, because it turns out that the reason oxygen is so reactive is because it's the same reason that you can generate so much energy from it. You know, burning can be very destructive, but it generates a lot of heat, right? So some of the critters started making oxygen, and everyone else had two choices. Well, three, but one of them, you know, you could die. That's not really a choice. You could hide away from the oxygen. That's reasonable. Or you could try to use the oxygen and detoxify it and maybe get a little bit of bang for your buck. And so that fateful moment back 3.5 billion years ago, when that primordial soup critter decided, you know what, I'm going to detoxify this oxygen, and I'm going to use it and make some energy while I'm at it, was the beginning of what is in this room right now and what is outside of this room. It's the beginning of the ability for animals and plants to generate energy from oxygen. And the really interesting thing is that in a lot of ways, at the chemical level, the way that animals came up to detoxify oxygen was by burning it. So this candle that we see right here, right now, is a burning candle, and it is converting the long carbon-containing molecules, which doesn't really, the wax, let's be honest, it's just wax. It's converting wax into CO2 and heat. It's CO2, it's burning, using oxygen to convert the wax into CO2. And that's such an energetic process that heat is coming off. Now, that requires oxygen. And so if you were to take this candle, I should not take credit for this experiment. Joseph Priestley did this experiment in the 1800s. And you can all guess what's going to happen, is that this candle is going to go out. Because it's going to run out of oxygen. Just like us as people, burning oxygen with the exact same chemistry that candle is burning oxygen will go out if we don't have enough oxygen around. And so this is sort of leads us to this paradox of the love-hate relationship that we have with oxygen. On one hand, we absolutely require it to live. Every single case of a human dying almost without, I can't think of an exception. If you guys can, please tell me. Without exception, is due to the fact that at some point, oxygen stopped being delivered to vital body parts. And at the same time, oxygen is horribly toxic. Every breath we take, the oxygen coming into our body causes a little bit more damage. And that damage caused by oxygen is what many people believe leads to aging and all of the diseases that go along with getting older. So the difference, I would say, the main difference that we have as animals that burn our oxygen relative to this candle is that on some level we get to control how fast we use our oxygen. When an animal is placed into, right now you and I, we're sitting in this room, it has about 20% oxygen in it. This candle quit burning because it got down to about less than about 5% oxygen, which is about the same place that you and I are going to be dead. 5% oxygen would happen if you and I were to be immediately transferred to the top of Mount Everest. It would not end well for all of us. On the other hand, we can many people can go up to the top of Rainier and be okay. That's about 16% oxygen. And if you stand up at the top of Rainier for long enough, a couple weeks, then, you know, maybe a third of us could then manage to be, if we were really fit and we'd worked really hard at it, we could then get to the top of Everest. And we could stay there for about 2 minutes before we'd have to come down. So really, Everest is the limit of humans. And the reason, but the thing is that this is not true of all animals. There are birds, they're called, there's a special goose species, it doesn't matter what they're called. But every year as they migrate, they fly over the top of Everest and all the Himalayas and they go to Tibet. And then they turn around in the spring and they fly all the way back over the top. And they're not only at a high enough elevation that would kill any human, but they're working really hard because they're flying the whole time. And so this leads you to think about, it's like, how is it that some animals can do that, but we cannot? As a human, if somebody were to have a heart attack, you'd have about 5 minutes of their heart not beating before brain cells start to die. After about 10 to 15 minutes, it's not looking good. So our cells can last a couple of minutes without oxygen. This goose is flying around with all, like in the space suit almost, doing perfectly fine. Why is it? What that means is that oxygen, the way we need it, is not universally required for life. And if that's true, could we think about, as scientists now, can we try and think about ways to make humans not need oxygen in times when they can't have it? And really, this is sort of an economics argument, right? So right now, we're all sitting in 20% oxygen, which is pretty much what we've evolved to really want to have around, so we're pretty happy. However, at any point, if the oxygen, amount of oxygen in this room were to change, to be less than what we're used to, we would still want 20%, and our body would be trying to act like we had 20%, but the supply and the demand are now not matching. And though I'm not very good at economics, I've been told that when supply and demand are not matching, that corrections happen. And so, if we take that analogy just a little bit further and say, is the reason that people die when they don't get enough oxygen because the supply and demand are not matching? Then, if that is true, might not, if we were able to reduce the demand, people wouldn't die when there was less oxygen around. And now, obviously, the room air is not going to change. Although there is a finite probability for anyone who's taken physics that at any time, all the oxygen molecules in this room might inadvertently, accidentally end up in that corner and then we would all suffocate, the probability of that happening is very, very small. And so I'm going to take this moment because, for two reasons. First of all, because I think it's my job as a scientist. And second of all, because I see youngsters in the room and I think they should know this, that nobody ever knows anything. And everyone should realize this. Scientists, we're told that we're supposed to say we know things. But really, at any point in time, all of the oxygen molecules could go to that side of the room. It is a thing that has a finite probability that could happen sometime. I don't know. Nobody knows anything. All we can do is do experiments and then extrapolate, and we make correlations. And I think that's a really important thing. It's like, I don't know the cause of anything, but I can correlate a lot of things with other things. All right, so back to my story. Why is it that we need oxygen to live? And really, the basis of that question is, what goes wrong when we don't have oxygen? And how is it that other animals who don't have oxygen do okay? So we were thinking about this a lot. And one night, the fellow I work with, his name is Mark Roth. He's a research scientist at the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center. And one of the great things about the Hutch is that you can sometimes get money to try random things. And Mark is really good at convincing them to give him money to do random things. And he had been watching, and this is not a planned plug, I swear, but he had been watching Nova on KCTS. Yeah, which is a fantastic show, I agree. And it was a Nova show about these caves in New Mexico called Lechuguilla. And the Lechuguilla caves are special because they're beautiful. They have these fantastic rock formations that you just can't see anywhere else. But the problem is that the reason they have such fantastic rock formations is that they're situated right above a whole little pool of volcanic gases. And so the cave fills up with all this hydrogen sulfide gas and all these other toxic chemicals, and it forms these really corrosive acids, actually, which then eats away at the rock and leaves these fantastic formations that are just gorgeous. Like, you should go Google Lechuguilla Caves at some point and see the beautiful pictures. The problem is that you can't really see Lechuguilla Caves in person because there's such high levels of hydrogen sulfide gas that come up from the volcanic deposits that if you walk down into the caves, you will take one breath and then you will fall over. And that is generally what we could call an end-of-life event. Unless you happen to be with somebody who's a little bit more prepared than you are, who has a gas mask, and is able to come in and pull you out of the cave. Now, if you didn't hit your head on the way down, what happens is that as soon as you're in normal air again, you basically wake up and you're fine. And this isn't just like one random person who happened to spastically survive in a weird place. Because it turns out that hydrogen sulfide is used industrially a lot. And this event happens so frequently, unfortunately, that it has a name. It's called a knockdown. And it's called a knockdown because as long as you can get out of the hydrogen sulfide, you'll start breathing again and you'll be fine. Now, I've started throwing around the word hydrogen sulfide like it's a thing that everybody knows about. And you all do, though you may not realize it. So if anyone has ever smelled a rotten egg, sewer gas, the springs at Yellowstone, the sulfur springs at Yellowstone, certain gases produced in the intestine of people and animals. This is for the little guys over here. That's fart smell. Hydrogen sulfide is all around us. It doesn't smell good. And in fact, it is a well-known metabolic poison. And what that means is that it attaches to the exact same place in your body where oxygen is used and prevents your body from using oxygen. Now, when we're up here with a demand at 20%, and all of a sudden we're not using our oxygen, that's bad. But one of the things after we were thinking a lot about hydrogen sulfide, after seeing these stories about these caves in Lechuguilla and learning about these knockdown events, I'm like, you know what that is? For a brief moment, that person didn't need oxygen. They weren't using oxygen, and they woke up and they were fine. And that seems, maybe that's a jump, right? They could have just been not breathing very much. But it turns out that there's this long history in medicine of us realizing that there are times when people seem like they're dead, but they're not. This has led to a sort of common standard operating procedure in hospitals now, is that you're not dead unless you're warm and dead. Every winter, there's at least one person who wanders out into the snowdrift or falls coming out of their car and ends up in a, usually it's a small child, unfortunately, ends up in a snowdrift in only a diaper. And when they are found, their core body temperature is usually very, very low. So right now, I'm sorry, I'm a scientist, I have difficulty converting measurements, which seems counterintuitive. But right now, we're all sitting at 37 degrees centigrade. That's normal body temperature for a human. That's normal body temperature for almost all animals, actually. But if you were to decrease your core body temperature to about 30 degrees centigrade, you would be in massive hypothermia. At 28 degrees centigrade, heartbeat stops. And below that, you're just, you know, popsicle. But it turns out that if you go across and you ask all of the emergency rooms, how many people got brought in who had a core body temperature of less than 32 degrees, so extreme hypothermia, and how many of them had no heartbeat, had no pulse, had no breathing when they were brought in? It's a fairly large amount. And say, how many of them, when you warmed them up, were okay? 80%. This is a New England Journal of Medicine report. 80% of people who came in with no heartbeat, some for as long as 6 hours, upon rewarming, were fine. And we're not talking like, fine, I'm living in a coma and eating out of a breathing tube. Like, there are people who went on to do graduate school and become doctors and work in the same emergency rooms that helped rewarm them. So this leads us to the idea that people, though we all think of ourselves as animated, we're fully active all the time, we're born, we grow up, we live our lives, we're always doing something, is that we have the possibility in ourselves to enter into a state of suspended animation, where we're not burning oxygen, we're not being active, but we're not dead. And I say that only because this raises a sort of question that I think we'll all have to have another beer to think about more. And that is, what does it mean to be dead? Because really what I've just said, all of that relies on the definition of dead being not being able to be alive. But really, in hospitals, most of the time, the definition of dead is has no heartbeat. And that doesn't hold when you're cold, which is an interesting thing to think about. So we were thinking about hydrogen sulfide then, and we're wondering if the knockdowns are like being in suspended animation, and if that doesn't help us to survive the lack of oxygen. And so we got Mark. When we say we, I can't take credit for this. Mark Roth got the Hutch to pay money to allow him to do an experiment. And the experiment was simple. The experiment was to put a mouse in a bowl, the normal amount of oxygen that we always have in the air, but add just a little bit of hydrogen sulfide and say, what happens to that mouse? And many people, in fact, predicted that, well, you added a toxic gas to the bowl, the mouse will die. And at first, you know, they sort of looked like they might be right. The mouse got really quiet, sort of just sat there, quit breathing very often. And we could measure its core body temperature, like how warm it was inside. And you could see the core body temperature just drop to what the room was. Parked it there for 6 hours. Didn't look like it was doing much. Then turned off the hydrogen sulfide. And now this comes back to our definition. Our definition was it's not dead if it was able to be alive. So after 6 hours, the graduate student who was doing this experiment turned off the hydrogen sulfide, watched the mouse. And the mouse started breathing again. And the mouse started running around in the bowl. And then he tossed a little cotton in there, and the mouse made a little nest out of it. And then the mouse went on to live for about 2 years and had 3 or 4 litters of little mice. The mouse was perfectly fine, passed a whole battery of behavior tests, like things that mice should be able to do. Which, the best one, I've got to say, just as anecdotally, there's this thing they call it the rotor rod. It's a little stick that twirls. And you put the mouse on it and ask how long it can stand up there, which is entertaining on so many levels. And this mouse was great at it, which is apparently a measure of its coordination and how well it's able to, like, think about the fact that the ground is twirling under. I don't even know, right? But it's fantastic. So this mouse was perfectly fine. And the other 15 mice that he did this to were perfectly fine. And this led to an obvious question. And the question is, if the mouse isn't breathing, does it need oxygen? Right? And so Eric Blackstone, who did these experiments, went on and he did the exact same experiment, except for this time he added the hydrogen sulfide and then he took away the oxygen. And if you do this to a normal mouse that hasn't seen hydrogen sulfide, the mouse has about 12 minutes before it dies. But the mouse that had been treated with hydrogen sulfide, after 1 hour, Eric got hungry and decided he was going to go get himself some dinner. And so he turned it off. The mouse was alive. The next 8 mice for 1 hour and no oxygen were alive. So basically, what Eric had done in that experiment is to show that there are times where you can lower the supply of oxygen and it doesn't matter. And then, well, that's a cute trick, right? But it really doesn't help us much unless we can predict when all the oxygen molecules are going to move over to that side of the room, which I've told you I can't do. But a lot of people every day die from heart attacks. And a lot of people every day die from having a stroke. And a lot of people die every day because they can't get enough blood to their kidneys. We call this kidney ischemia. It's a fancy word for it. And the inability to get oxygen to your tissues kills people every day. And so we thought that really what we want to think about is not can we change the amount of oxygen that's in the air and help these animals live, but can hydrogen sulfide protect these animals when their body organs can't get blood flow because of these sorts of these conditions. So in the fancy science words, this is called preclinical animal models. So Eric, well, this wasn't Eric anymore. We'd moved on now to a new graduate student at this point. Folks in the lab started to think about this. And one of the things that we got interested in was in severe blood loss. And I will tell you a dirty secret of science now. And we got interested in severe blood loss because someone paid us to be interested in severe blood loss. And that was the U.S. military. Because it turns out a lot of soldiers die when they get shot and they lose a lot of blood. And this is a problem. And really, losing a lot of blood is the same thing as not getting oxygen to your tissues, because your blood carries the oxygen. And so folks in the lab started to think about whether or not hydrogen sulfide might protect animals from losing a lot of blood. And it turns out that if you take a rat and you treat it with hydrogen sulfide, or not, and then you remove 60% of its blood, what you will find is that animals not treated with hydrogen sulfide will die. This is not a surprising event. We all need our blood to live. It's a good thing, generally. But if you treat a rat with hydrogen sulfide and take away 60% of its blood, and after 3 hours, if you give it some water to drink, it will be fine. Now, what this is doing in a rat is just saving them. But what we really hope to be doing in people more is to buy some time. Because it turns out that doctors are really good at what they do. And if only they had a little bit more time, losing 60% of your blood as a person wouldn't be so horrible. It's not good. You shouldn't try to run out and do it. I'm not advocating that. But the problem is that soldiers get shot in places where it takes them quite a while to get to a hospital. And so what we're hoping is that by using hydrogen sulfide, a soldier now will be able to survive long enough to get to a hospital and be treated and not go into the shock and the horrible medical reactions that happen when you don't have enough blood. And that's great for soldiers, but really this also implies that, has anyone heard of the 5-minute rule when it comes to heart attacks? It's this sort of CPR thing. I'm blind and I can still see some folks. So if you have a heart attack, if you get to a hospital within 5 minutes, your odds of survival are actually pretty good. And then it drops about exponentially. And what that means is, like, if you look at the odds of survival as a function, so time is going this way. Within 5 minutes, you're doing pretty well, and then all of a sudden it goes. If you can get to a hospital, it's great. But what if you live out in the middle of nowhere? Or what if the roads are busy? Or what if you get to the hospital right at 5 minutes, but the doctor takes another 2 minutes to run down the hall, right? So what if we could just add 10 minutes onto that? You know how many people would not be dead from a heart attack if instead of 5 minutes, you gave them 15 minutes? Almost everybody in the United States lives within 15 minutes of a hospital. So a fellow who is not in our lab, but is affiliated with the Safar Center in Philadelphia, wondered whether or not mice might do better after having an induced heart attack if you gave them hydrogen sulfide. And so what he found was that normally the way he does this is just to cut off the flow of blood to part of the mouse's heart. And this is bad. That's what a heart attack is. It's not good. The mice that got treated with hydrogen sulfide within 15 minutes of the occlusion, or the heart attack, had 1/10 the amount of heart muscle damage as the untreated animals. This was one of the best preclinical animal models of heart attack improvement that has ever been seen. And so since that time, and actually it started a little bit before that, but we decided that this was a really important thing, and people need to be able to do this. And so we need to learn how to make this technology appropriate for humans. And so a company was started, and they have been using hydrogen sulfide to do these preclinical animal models. And also, as of this summer, we are in phase 2 human trials to improve outcome after cardiac bypass surgery. And so far, phase 2 trials are... it's a long, tedious story, but so far things are looking good, I would say. And that leads us to, now we're thinking about using suspended animation to make people survive in these horrible conditions. And I may have led you all to think that this is, like, understood. But I told you before, we don't know crap. We don't know what we're talking about. And so one of you, the obvious question that probably a lot of you have is, well, how does that work? And I will have to say, the answer is, I do not know, but isn't that awesome? I have no idea how that works. But this is basically what we're going to be talking about in my lab. What we're studying is, like, how does that work? Like, how is it that you can give this toxic thing to this animal, and now they're doing better? Which is sort of the same thing you can think about. Is like, how is it that you have oxygen, and it's toxic, but it's important. And now we have this hydrogen sulfide, which is toxic, but your body cells are making it all the time. We don't have to actually add it to you. Most people, I mean all people, all animals, make hydrogen sulfide in their cells all the time. So is this the same thing? Is it just like, you can't have too little, and you can't have too much, but you need the right amount. And maybe the right amount changes depending on what the circumstances are. And I don't know the answer to any of those questions. But just to give you a little insight into how we think about these things, one of the approaches that I'm taking is to do genetics. And what that means is that we want to find out what it is inside our bodies and our cells that helps us to have these responses to hydrogen sulfide, and that helps us to survive better in oxygen. And of course, you can't do this in people, because the part of the way you do genetics is that you get to control who mates with who. And people in general don't like to be told about who to mate with. It's a problem. Not only that, but I like people, I'm not gonna lie, most of them. But the generation time for people is really, really bad if you're a scientist. Because you cannot wait for 20 years to find out if you're mixing up your genetic material the way you wanted to worked or not. So we use what we call model organisms. Little critters that breed really fast and have a lot of progeny and will mate with whoever you tell them to. Learn something interesting. And the thing that we've learned is that just like in animals where we see hydrogen sulfide in these big furry animals, which we think about a lot, because we are one of them, and so we care. In big furry animals, hydrogen sulfide seems to have beneficial effects. But in these little worms, hydrogen sulfide also has beneficial effects. And one of the interesting effects is if you grow a worm in hydrogen sulfide, it will live for 70% longer lifespan than its sibling that has all the same genes but is grown in room air. That's like saying a person who would normally live to be 100 has now lived to be 170. And there is one gene that mediates this effect. And that gene, which I found by genetics, is conserved in people. And in fact, is the same gene that some people say, is anyone drinking red wine tonight? It is the same gene that is supposedly responsible for mediating the effects of red wine to increase your lifespan in people. And so this is interesting that we're now finding these convergences between these small little worms and our red wine and our people. And it's a story that is, I would say, in its infancy, but which I think is pretty entertaining to consider. And so with that, I'm gonna stop. I'm gonna let folks refill, and maybe y'all reconsider and get some red wine, although beer is good too. And then I'll be happy to take questions.
Okay, we're gonna take about a 10-minute break, which means we will reconvene at 10 to 8. I will come bring the mic to you. And it may seem silly to ask your question into a mic when it's kind of a small room, but all these questions are being recorded, and they're also gonna be part of the video on KCTS9, so it would be really nice if people at home could hear you. So we ask that you ask your question into the mic. So who's first?
Sarah's first.
All right.
What got you interested in this field?
What got me interested in this field? So my academic path has been guided almost entirely by things that I thought were fun. And what got me interested in this field is that it seemed like a thing that would never work. And so the fellow that I work with to do this and I have a lot of fun thinking about things that seem so wacky they could never be true, and then trying to prove that they are true. And that is why I think this is so fun.
The gene that you mentioned, is it one that all people possess? And if so, are there variants of the gene that may be more or less effective in the regard that you were talking about?
So the gene that I was talking about, and I didn't say the name because it makes me sound wonky, is called SIRT1. And it was first actually discovered as a gene in yeast, which are the little critters that help us make our beer and our bread. And it is conserved in people. And it turns out, actually, that people have seven different flavors of this gene. And there have been, to my knowledge, no variations between people that alter its activity. But I suspect that it is a matter of time before someone associates it with some sort of disease or another, because pretty much every gene is being associated with something these days. But we don't know very much about what it's actually doing or how it's having these effects in people, especially when it comes, it's been associated with the ability of mammals to have increased lifespan when you give them resveratrol, which is the compound in red wine that supposedly makes it causes us to live longer. But nobody knows how that really works, I would say. There's a, I don't know where the microphone is now. Over here, it looks like.
So am I right to assume that hydrogen sulfide was around in the primitive Earth?
Thank you for asking that question. I did not plant her, but that's like a fantastic question. So hydrogen sulfide was actually more common than oxygen back in the day when our primitive life was evolving. Because it turns out that you can find hydrogen sulfide all over the world today, in part because bacteria that can't stand oxygen make it. So before there was oxygen around, almost all bacteria made it. And there was a very, very high levels of hydrogen sulfide relative to what we have floating around in the world today. And so hydrogen sulfide was, in fact, very common in the back in the primitive world day.
So is there a connection between that and the origin of life?
Wow. There's certainly a correlation, I would say. The origin of life biology is sort of a thing that I find really, really entertaining, but I don't know very much about it. So I would say that, I'll say yes, because probably you're right, but I don't know that anyone's done any experiments that sort of like show that is true or not, right? But I think that it's certainly a thing that you can't get away from the fact that when all the little biochemistry that was evolving, the biochemistry that runs our cells was evolving, there was a lot of hydrogen sulfide around and not very much oxygen around. And right now in our bodies, though we're breathing 20% oxygen, the amount of oxygen that actually gets to all of our little cells is not nearly as much. And so it may be that we have built a skin and we've aggregated our cells in such a way that really, even today, the amount of hydrogen sulfide is relatively high compared to the amount of oxygen. And maybe we're all just giant sea mats covered up in an epidermis, and that's how we're living, right?
Do creatures under the influence of hydrogen sulfide continue to age?
Well, yes. I would say that time marches on in all conditions. The worms that live 70% longer do continue to age. They just do so more slowly. In all of the sort of experiments that we've done with bigger animals, the time that we've exposed them to hydrogen sulfide has only been for a few hours. And so that becomes, we don't know the answer, I would say, to that question. But it's interesting that we're hitting a lot of targets that people think are involved in aging in people. But that's just me waving my hands, which is a scientist's way of saying, I don't know. All right, then the microphone has to come this way, too.
You bet. First of all, thanks for coming out. All we seem to hear about is carbon dioxide now, so it's nice to get oxygen. It's due here. But I had two questions about the balance between that, because we have this nice thing where the plants make carbon dioxide and the animals need, or oxygen. So is the balance in that, the two questions, one, is it stable over great periods of time, do you think? And if so, is that evidence of some sort of more meta being, you know, referred to as the whole Earth or Gaia or whatever that's called?
So that's a really interesting question. So I would just say empirically it seems that the balance is not stable, because it turns out that in the Cenozoic, which was several hundred million years ago, the amount of oxygen that was in the air was actually much higher. We were up around 35% oxygen. And one of the interesting things about having a lot of oxygen around is that critters get big. Really big. So this is in the age when bugs were like the size of a room, right? That's probably hyperbole, but they're really, really big. And not big like cockroaches in Florida big, like big. And so there's the interesting thing is, and I don't know enough about this, I'm sure, but as organic material, plants and trees and stuff get buried, then the amount of CO2 that can be produced gets stored up in the amount of carbon that they have under the ground. And it's a really intricate cycle. And these are all, and their balance is very delicate, I would say. And so the balance isn't stable. It clearly fluctuates over time. As people, if the world were suddenly to go to 35% oxygen again, we would all be in a world of hurt. Because oxygen, that amount of oxygen would be enough to toughen up our lungs and probably take 20 years off everybody's life, at least, if not more. Because oxygen is really not good for you. But we're pretty acclimated to what we have now. But if it were to change dramatically, we'd be in a world of hurt. And so when you get back to like the Gaia and Lovelock's hypotheses about how the Earth is a big, more connected thing, when you talk to James Lovelock, who's the author of the Gaia hypothesis that came up with this whole idea that everything, that the world is sort of a, that the Earth is sort of a living being to an extent and interacts with the animals that live on it. It is true that all animals not only require the environment they live in, but also change the environment they live in. And so when you talk to him on one level, it is true that we're all connected and that those things seem to be really robust sort of interdependencies. But he didn't, the sort of short interactions I've had with him is that he really didn't mean to think that the world was a living being so much as that it was a delicate balance of so many interacting systems that it's easy to throw it off balance. And that, I think, is very valid. Where are we at now? Who has the microphone? Okay, over here.
I was wondering how the behavior of carbon monoxide is different than hydrogen sulfide as far as, because carbon monoxide has sort of similar effects where it bonds with the red blood cells and displaces oxygen.
So the interesting thing is that hydrogen sulfide seems not to so much interact with the ability of red blood cells to carry oxygen. Instead, it interacts with the molecules on your mitochondria that use the oxygen. And the fun thing is that hydrogen sulfide goes in fast and binds and then goes off fast. So its pharmacokinetics, in a fancy word, are very good. Whereas carbon monoxide has the unfortunate side effect of actually going in, binding up and preventing your red blood cells from carrying oxygen, but not actually stopping your cells from needing the oxygen. And so carbon monoxide poisoning, we think, might be a sort of one of those examples of when your cellular demand is still very high, but the supply is low. And so there are certain situations where CO does seem, carbon monoxide does have some sort of beneficial effects, but those are all blood-free. So for instance, some of the folks who I work with have been really interested in using carbon monoxide to improve the time that you're able to store organs for transplantation. So right now, a big problem is that a lot of people need livers and kidneys and hearts, but there aren't very many around. And not only that, to add on to the problem is that sometimes there's a person in Michigan that really needs a heart, and a person in New York City who has one that's ready to donate, and it takes too long to move the heart from New York City to Michigan. And so if you can improve the shelf life of donor tissue by about, I've been told, on the order of 12 to 18 hours, you might almost obliterate the deficit in donor tissues that we have these days. And so we've been working actually to try and use carbon monoxides, which seems very effective at preserving some tissues, to improve the ability to transport donor organs and such in that capacity. But in a whole critter, the blood thing is just a non-starter.
It's been a long time since I've had chemistry, so I may be wrong here. But it seems like hydrogen sulfide is H2S, and
yes,
sulfur is in the same column in the periodic chart as oxygen. So oxygen or water and hydrogen sulfide probably have some similarities. Then would this effect be related to what you were talking about, hydrogen sulfide doing good things?
I, you know, I think yes. I would have to say it has always struck us that sulfur is right underneath oxygen on the periodic chart. And oxygen has some interesting chemistry that makes it fairly unique. But sulfur, so oxygen, as you might guess from its name, is a very good oxidizing agent. So it can grab electrons. And sulfur, it turns out, is a very good reducing agent. Because of the way its electrons are arranged, it has an extra layer of them. But you can go one underneath that, and you'll find selenium. And selenium is an essential micronutrient. Your body, and all animals actually, have a conserved pathway to incorporate selenium into proteins and use it as a redox agent. And there have been a lot of people who have made claims about selenium being very good for you. Selenium also quite toxic. So there was a recent event, actually, where there's a vitamin that, I forget the name, some fancy vitamin company was selling these, like, multivitamins to people, and they accidentally put 10 times more selenium in than they meant to. And I think somebody died. Like, it's not good for you. So don't go out and, like, OD on selenium. It's not going to make you live longer. But all of these things in this column have similar chemical properties, because you're right. Things that are in the same group in a periodic table behave similarly. And we wonder if that doesn't have a lot to do with some of the interesting effects that we see when we treat animals with sulfide. But we haven't really been able to, say it with any sort of scientific rigor. But I think it's more than just a coincidence that they're right next to each other like that. I think that's a really interesting point.
Back to your question about your research on the mice, mm-hmm. when you expose them to the hydrogen sulfide and then you tested the control mice that hadn't been exposed and then the ones that had been, and the ones that had been exposed didn't die when you deprived them completely of oxygen and gave them all hydrogen sulfide. So then carrying that forward to your experiments on the blood loss, would that mean that you'd need to do some sort of an inoculation to soldiers as they're going into battle or something like that? Is that part of your experiments or your trials?
Yeah, so that's a really, that raises up a pragmatically hugely important question. And that is, if you can devise a drug that can protect you against heart attacks, but only if you take it 24 hours before you have a heart attack, is that good? And I would say that probably that's not going to be so useful. A lot of our work with hydrogen sulfide has shown that, so for instance with cardiac bypass surgery, which they're using it for in human trials now, cardiac bypass surgery, you know when someone's going to have surgery. It's a scheduled surgery. And you can actually treat people in preclinical animal models, up to 24 hours before the surgery, and they'll be improved outcome. But in the blood loss, when we're talking about improving survival of animals after blood loss, what we found is that, in fact, you can treat them with hydrogen sulfide at the end of the blood loss period, and you'll see improved outcome. That was really important for the military, because let me tell you, the military is not interested in pre-treating their soldiers with anything. because it's very, very expensive to treat everybody in this room or everybody in the whole of Kirkland just to know that one of them is going to be better off. It turns out that actually the cost benefit is sort of not good there. So we really have been trying to optimize it to be a thing that you can use in the field at the event and not have to pre-treat. Although I think that it's interesting, the biology about why it could work both ways or one versus the other is sort of entertaining. Because how does your body know that 24 hours ago it saw hydrogen sulfide? We don't know. So that's sort of the answer to that.
Well, so does that mean that the effects are pretty short-lived? Have you been able to test how long it'll last?
One of the things, so when you want to get FDA approval to use something as a drug, one of the things that you care very much about is a thing called PK/PD, which is a shorthand for a ridiculously long term, pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. And PK/PD means that you measure how long things last in the system and how much of a dose it takes to cause certain effects, blah, 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 blah. And so the company has been really interested to nail down the PK/PD of hydrogen sulfide. And it turns out that like a single dose of hydrogen sulfide when given to a human lasts only for a few minutes in the bloodstream before it's totally converted into something else and goes away. And the something else that it's converted to most of the time is urine, because almost all of the sulfur that you ingest through your body ends up as urine at some point. But it's really fast. It's short-lived, and it's in, and it's out, and it's gone, as far as we know.
So have you checked to see if Yellowstone Park rangers live longer?
I don't think anyone's done that. However, there is there are a whole host of hot springs around the world that are well known for their curative effects for a variety of illnesses, and many of them smell bad. And yet people drink the water out of them, which is really gross.
So, if a person doesn't have kidneys, or you know they've lost whatever kidney function they had, and you treated them with hydrogen sulfide,
is that the end of the question?
Yeah.
Oh goodness.
Sorry.
So if a person doesn't have kidneys,
or
and then I treat them with hydrogen sulfide, what would happen? Well, I think they're going to die because they don't have any kidneys. To be
That's
honest,
what I thought.
kidneys are really important in general for life.
Yeah.
The kidneys are certainly where a lot of things get filtered out of the blood. But most of the time, when you give somebody a drug and it's going to get converted into something else, that happens in the liver. And so, it's been shown by groups as far back as 1960, I believe, that if you put hydrogen sulfide into liver extract or even red blood cells, that it will get converted into more oxidized forms. So hydrogen sulfide, since I know there's at least one person who's taking chemistry here, hydrogen sulfide is in the 2- oxidation state, and sulfur, the yellow powder that you see, is in the S0 oxidation state. And when you add sulfide in the 2- oxidation state to blood cells or liver extract, it will get readily converted into S0. And so it's clear there's some biological activity to alter sulfide and use it in certain, or do things to it. But we're still working on what that means in biology and physiology.
One more question, this time related to the mice. Does the action of hydrogen sulfide, is it more or less like hibernation? Or is it used in hibernation?
So
the same pathways?
Thank you. Again, another question I didn't plan. That was fantastic. Hibernation in mammals is generally defined based on what it looks like, which is tedious when it comes scientifically. But basically, the way we know something is hibernating is that its metabolic rate drops and then its core body temperature falls to whatever ambient or whatever the room is. And the mice that are exposed to hydrogen sulfide, mice don't normally hibernate, but they do all the same things that we associate with hibernation. Now, we're not allowed to call it a hibernation-like event because of peer review, which we can all talk about some other time. But physiologically, hibernation and the hydrogen sulfide-induced state in mice, or in rodents at least, seem very, very similar. But that being said, we've also not, though we haven't really looked very hard, but we haven't found any evidence that hydrogen sulfide is important for naturally hibernating animals. Although I think that would be super, super cool.
I was wondering, how long have people been able to survive in those knockout situations and then been able to bring back?
The knockdowns? Yeah. That's a super question. So I will tell you another fun story about college hazing. So this is a college hazing event, which is written in the medical literature from 1894, I believe. Which, yes, there apparently was hazing in the late 19th century. But apparently there was an event there where some fraternity brother thought it would be really, really entertaining if they were to get a skunk to spray on a handkerchief, and then when the newbie was coming through, hold the handkerchief over his face until he passed out. And this person did, in fact, pass out, and was passed out for about, I believe, 2.5 hours. And when the doctor was finally called, his core body temperature was, I believe, 34.5 or so, which is pretty cold. And they blew some oxygen at him and cleared out the room, and he was fine. Most industrial knockdowns, you don't get a chance to see how long they're going to last because the emergency people are there like that, and it's over. So as far as I know, that's the record for a stinky substance-mediated knockdown event.
Are there any dangers that you've seen in treating with hydrogen sulfide?
So I would say that there are no dangers in treating with the low levels of hydrogen sulfide that we have seen. However, people die from hydrogen sulfide gas in a non-treatment regimen when they fall into sewers or when they're in an industrial knockdown and no one is around to pull them out appropriately, or when their friend falls into a sewer and they don't know what's going on and they go in after them and then everyone dies. These things happen every year. Hydrogen sulfide, I'm not trying to tell you that it's a panacea or the wonder drug. It is a toxic gas and it can kill you, but that's in very high concentrations. And the amount we're talking about is much lower. So I would say this is maybe a plug for moderation, but anything will kill you at a high enough level. You can drink enough water to die, okay? So I think it's really all about finding what we call the therapeutic index, which is just in easy words, enough that it's good, but not so much that it's bad. But as far as we know, it's not toxic in therapeutic doses.
So isn't the anti-aging industry all over you for this great invention? I can just see us all going to the spas and breathing in.
Yeah, you know, while it may be that hydrogen sulfide will increase your lifespan, I think this comes out, maybe this is an ethical or philosophical question, in that do you want to live longer if you smell like a rotten egg? There are people, I will not kid you, that call our lab fairly regularly volunteering for trials, which, let's just be clear, you're not allowed to do. I can't do a trial on a person, even if I wanted to. So don't call. And I'm going to chalk this up to one of those, like, let's be careful what we wish for. Like, I want to live to be healthy longer. I think that's a great, great goal for all of science and all of biomedical research. I'm not sure that it is reasonable or even a good idea to suggest that people should live to be 200 years old or even 150 years old. We sort of have a population problem as it is. And I have a 3-year-old, and I'm happy to clear the way and give her a little bit of space. That's just my own personal views, not in any way reflecting the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center, the National Institutes of Health, or any other place that may give me money.